So, as I mentioned, kids, we are celebrating a very special day today, and it's called All Saints. And we have something here that you might recognize. A candle! You recognized it! You've seen a candle before? Really? This is like old school tech. It is! When have you seen a candle before? What do you usually light candles for? Do any of you, this is a kind of a strange thing to ask, but do any of you ever like light candles and put it on top of cake?
Yes.
You do? Really? That's so weird. Do you eat the candles? No? Why do you do that? Why do you put a candle on top of a cake? All right. Well, thanks for coming up. You don't know why you put a candle on a cake?
Celebrating your birthday.
Oh, yes! Celebrating your birthday. So do you just put one candle on your cake?
Sometimes, if you're one.
If you're one. It represents what? You're 1 year old. If you have one candle, how many candles did you have in your last cake, Zach?
Seven.
Seven? Maya, how about you? Five, Colton? Seven? You had to think about that one. Oh, it's coming up close, huh? Oh, you had eight. Okay, Lily, how about you? How many candles? Two. And so she had one candle. Nice. Sometime you'll get old enough where you have too many years to fit the candles on the cake. Oh, you could do number? Oh, I haven't gotten to that point yet. No. But we celebrate what a gift you are from God for that whole year by lighting a candle. And we're lighting candles today in worship to celebrate the lives of people, their whole lives, and all the years that God has given them with us. And that's kind of one of the meanings of lighting it. Another really neat meaning is that no matter how small the candle and how small the light, can there be enough darkness that it's never, that the darkness wins, that it will put out the light just because it's so dark?
No.
Now, if you blow it out, you can blow it out, right? But if you don't blow it out, no matter if it is as dark as it possibly can get, even the stars aren't out, even the moon's not out, there's no electric light, there's nothing in the middle of nowhere. Or if you go, like I went down in a deep, deep cave once, and then we turned out the lights, and there was no possible source of light, and it was as dark as you could be, as dark. And if you lit, yeah, darker. And if you lit, and it was scary, actually, when we turned the lights out. But if you lit one little candle, then that light just dispels all the darkness. That's kind of cool, too. So, next time that you put those candles on your birthday cake, you can think about what a gift God has given in you. And we celebrate your whole life. All right, let's pray. Gracious Heavenly Father, thank you for the light that shines so brightly in these kids. Be with them now as they learn more about your love in Sunday school. Amen. And be with their teacher, Emily. All right, you can head on back. And we continue to prepare our hearts for worship. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, the strength of our ancestors, healer of our every ill, source of unending mercy. Amen. Embraced in enduring grace and hope, let us turn again to God, confessing the truth about ourselves. Merciful God, we come before you, beloved but broken. We have not always treated others as we would want them to treat us. We have not always called out injustice and abuse. We have not always been kind to ourselves. We have not always taken care of the world we share with other living creatures. Remind us of who we are, beloved children bathed in your love. Renew us by your Spirit to live as your holy people, bringing healing to all around us. Amen. At every moment, you are held by the love of God, renewed by the Spirit within and among you, made alive again in Christ. Receive this assurance in Jesus' name. You are forgiven and freed to live for the healing of the world. Amen. And now, Carol is going to play some selections of music for a prelude, and I invite our acolyte to come forward first, then to light the altar candles, and then we'll have the families come forward one at a time to remember those whom we loved and have lost. Thanks, God, for Bill. We give you thanks, O Lord, for the gift of Norm. in all the ways that he brought love and laughter to all those who knew him. We remember now the gift of Barry Duhamel. Before you, Lord, Barry's faithfulness, his love for family, for those around him. And we give you thanks, Lord, for the gift of Lou Messini. That he was an encouragement to others, even though he could never lose his Boston accent. And now you are invited to light a candle in memory of any loved one you would like to honor today. You can come forward at any time.
Mary Oxner,
Dick and Bunny Truax, Don Hickey, Sue Albers, Michael Fahey, Bernard Holst, Milan Coles, Bob Isle, Marion and Gladys Peterson, Daryl Peterson, Clarence and Mildred Zilgit, Clara Pressure, Art Pressure, Earl Ellis, Marvel Ellis, Claire Hack, Don Pressure, Tom Volberding, Brian Thompson, Marie K. Wally, Bill Thewalt, Lynn Iverson, Judith Delane, Sarah Henneman, Alma Kohler, Mary Mundy. Let us pray. Almighty God, you have knit your people together in one communion in the mystical body of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Grant us grace to follow your blessed saints in lives of faith and commitment, and to know the inexpressible joys you have prepared for those who love you, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. And now we celebrate those who have been baptized within the last year here at Faith. And you may not recognize their names because they are grandchildren of members here that haven't found a church home where they are. So Blair Robin Windisch is the Hedquist granddaughter, was just baptized last week, and so that's wonderful. And then Lawson is the Smith's grandson, and Waylon is also the Fonnell's grandson. So I think Deb and Mike are the representatives here for those who are baptized. I'm not sure how this is going to work because this got really not how it's supposed to be. Hang on. Much better. We have these candles here in honor of those and celebrating the life of those baptized. Just light it up. Think of those more like the birthday candles and celebrating the life that goes on among us. And in honor, in the spirit of that, we sing together our opening hymn, hymn number 671, Shine, Jesus, Shine, verses 1 and 2. Please stand as you're able. Singing our hallelujahs. Sorry, that's not how we usually do it, so sorry, Scott. We're trying a different, we're changing settings now, so it's setting 10 if you wanted to look in your hymnal.
Kings. When Ahab saw Elijah, Ahab said to him, "Is it you, you troubler of Israel?" He answered, "I have not troubled Israel, but you have, and your father's house, because you have forsaken the commandments of the Lord and followed the Baals. Now therefore have all Israel assemble for me at Mount Carmel with the 450 prophets of Baal, and the 400 prophets of Asherah who eat at Jezebel's table. So Ahab sent to all the Israelites and assembled the prophets at Mount Carmel. Elijah then came near to all the people and said, "How long will you go limping with two different opinions? If the Lord is God, follow him. But if Baal, then follow him." The people did not answer him a word. Then Elijah said to the people, "I, even I only, am left a prophet of the Lord, but Baal's prophets number 450. Let two bulls be given to us. Let them choose one bull for themselves, cut it in pieces, and lay it on the wood, but put no fire to it. I will prepare the other bull and lay it on the wood, but put no fire to it. Then you call on the name of your God, and I will call on the name of the Lord. The God who answers by fire is indeed God." All the people answered, "Well spoken." Then Elijah said to the prophets of Baal, "Choose for yourselves one bull and prepare it first, for you are many. Then call on the name of your God, but put no fire to it." So they took the bull that was given them, prepared it, and called on the name of Baal from morning until noon, crying, "Oh, Baal, answer us." But there was no answer. There was no voice and no answer. They limped about the altar that they had made. At noon, Elijah mocked them, saying, "Cry aloud. Surely he is a god. Either he is meditating, or he has wandered away, or he is on a journey, or perhaps he is asleep and must be awakened." Then they cried aloud, and as was their custom, they cut themselves with swords and lances until the blood gushed out over them. As midday passed, they raved on until the time of the offering of the oblation, but there was no voice, no answer, and no response. Then Elijah said to all the people, "Come closer to me." And all the people came closer to him. First he repaired the altar of the Lord that had been thrown down. Elijah took 12 stones, according to the number of the tribes of the sons of Jacob, to whom the word of the Lord came, saying, "Israel shall be your name." With the stones he built an altar in the name of the Lord. Then he made a trench around the altar, large enough to contain 2 measures of seed. Next, he put the wood in order, cut the bull in pieces, and laid it on the wood. He said, "Fill 4 jars with water and pour it on the burnt offering and on the wood." Then he said, "Do it a second time." And they did it a second time. Again, he said, "Do it a third time." And they did it a third time, so that the water ran all around the altar and filled the trench also with water. At the time of the offering of the oblation, the prophet Elijah came near and said, "O Lord, God of Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, let it be known this day that you are God in Israel, that I am your servant, and that I have done all these things at your bidding. Answer me, O Lord, answer me, so that this people may know that you, O Lord, are God, and that you have turned their hearts back." Then the fire of the Lord fell and consumed the burnt offering, the wood, the stones, and the dust, and even licked up the water that was in the trench. When all the people saw it, they fell on their faces and said, "The Lord indeed is God. The Lord indeed is God." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. So I had meant to mention in the announcements that we're following the narrative lectionary, which takes us through the major stories of the Old Testament in the fall, and then leading up to the prophets and the prophecy of Jesus' birth, and then on to Christmas and the New Testament in the spring. And I always have the option of, during High Holy Days, to substitute that lesson for one more appropriate for the day. But I had made such a substitution last week for Reformation Day. And so early this week, I thought, well, I did that already. I better go back to the Old Testament. And then I've regretted it all week long. But, hear me out. I believe that it actually can speak a powerful word on this All Saints Day, too. Today we do celebrate all our saints, our loved ones who are now in their heavenly home, and we rejoice for them, but we grieve for ourselves in their loss. I find this to be a powerful service in which we remember and celebrate and mourn all at the same time. It's a very simple act, really. Just lighting a candle here in church. But it is also, in that simple act, a real physical representation of the light, their light, still shines, even among us here, right now. Jesus said, "Let your light so shine before others that they may see your good works and glorify our Father in heaven." We remember this verse at every baptism in the hope that our lights may indeed shine to inspire and encourage each other in mutual praise and hope in God. We light a candle now in memory of those we love because their light is not forgotten, and it still shines within us. There will come a time when their light will be forgotten. In generations to come, undoubtedly, we only go back so far in our living memories, right? But it is their light then that was passed down through the generations, through us, that will be remembered, the names known, the light, yes. When the Lord gives Moses the Ten Commandments, Moses tells the people that he warns them, yes, your sin, your disobedience, that will impact greatly to the third, even the fourth generation. They will suffer because of your disobedience. But the blessing of when you do good, that, God says, will be felt for the thousandth generation. So we often lament deeply the harm that we see people do in this world, and we should lament deeply when we see it. I have been struggling since Hamas terrorists invaded Israel and I have been struggling with how to understand the response. Prior to that, still struggling about Putin's invasion of Ukraine and the ongoing war there. These intractable and dehumanizing conflicts can lead us to a place of despair. It has seemed to me almost as if we humans are destined to destroy one another, one way or another, rather than make the necessary sacrifices for the sake of living together in a true, lasting, and just peace. But it is times like these that we can remember that though evil seems to win the day in this present moment, even the smallest unseen acts of love are 1,000 times more powerful in the end than the hate that we readily see today. That is a radical statement of faith. All Saints' Day, these small candles give us this insanely optimistic hope. Last week, we celebrated Reformation Day and reflected on how we are all both saint and sinner at the same time. Today, we are reminded that it is the saint part of us that lives forever with God, and that the seemingly insignificant and silent good that we do far outweighs the destructive and the loud evil that we also do. We know that the whole story is so much more beautiful and real than what we are experiencing and what we can experience and know right now, today. And this is our connection to that wild story about Elijah and his duel with the prophets of Baal. Unfortunately, we often misread this story so horribly because we're not hearing the whole story. The Reformation was all about bringing the whole of God's word to God's people, translating it into the vernacular language, a language that the people could understand. But the Lutheran Church ever since has done a horrible job of actually teaching people how to read this book. We just assume if you know the language, you'll know how to read it. But I think we see and learn time and time again what at first appears to mean one thing means something completely different in the context of the whole story. So if this is your only exposure to this story, we think this battle between Elijah and the prophets of Baal at Mount Carmel is about proving the superior power of our God and the greatness of Elijah, right? He wins. He wins big. He embarrasses those other prophets. It's awesome, right? Our assigned reading for today starts, remember, saying, Elijah came near to all the people. How long will you go limping between two different opinions? If the Lord is God, follow him. If Baal, then follow him. The people did not answer him a word. And then we end with that beautiful ending, right? It says, Elijah cried out, answer me, O Lord, answer me, so that this people may know that you, O Lord, are God, and that you have turned their hearts back. Then the fire of the Lord fell, and it consumed the burnt offering, despite being drenched with water three times. The wood, the stones, and the dust, and even licked up the water that was filled the trench around it. An awesome display of power, miraculously out of nowhere. It could only be God. And when all the people saw it, they fell on their faces and said, the Lord indeed is God. The Lord indeed is God. Victory for our people and our God, the one true God. That's a great lesson. Makes you feel good if you believe in that God. But the story doesn't stop there. Weird that they don't actually include the very next verse. Oh, it just happened to get a little bit too long for us? I don't think so. Here's what the next verse says. Elijah said to them, seize the prophets of Baal. Do not let one of them escape. Then they seized them, and Elijah brought them down to the Wadi Kishon and killed them there. Now, it would be horrible enough if we're talking about a few religious leaders. I mean, we could stand to lose a few religious leaders. But if you remember, it said There were 450 prophets of Baal, as well as 400 prophets of Asherah. They had all been assembled. Elijah had killed 850 prophets that day. 850 people who were just trying to honor the gods they were taught to believe in and to serve to the best of their ability. And he brought them out to a ditch and he murdered them. When you have this kind of power over your enemies, the answer Elijah assumes is that it is to be used in order to utterly destroy your enemy. That is what Stalin and Hitler did in World War II. That is what Putin and Hamas are trying to do right now. This is also what Israel is severely tempted to do in response. Ukraine, at least, simply seems to be trying to just defend itself and restore its borders, but that's only because that's the conceivable limit of their power. If they had enough power, is there any doubt that they would not also seek to absolutely destroy Putin and his minions? I think not. I think the border would not stop them. Elijah had this kind of power and chose it to use it to slaughter, or at least try to slaughter, all of his enemies. Strange how we didn't read that verse. The Gospel of our Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Obviously, we didn't read it because it no longer gives us that neat, tidy lesson that we want to hear. But what we heard today was merely setting the stage for the real lesson that Elijah must learn. When we only focus on one small part of the story, it's incredibly difficult to understand what's really going on, what the whole story is really all about. I had this experience in a very funny, inconsequential way just this week, as I was watching the high school play, WCKY Radio at the high school. Who, I know a few of you I recognize. Who, yep, you seen it? Yeah. It's, kids are just doing amazing, aren't they? Yeah. 2 o'clock show tonight. Anybody that wants to go, the my own kids are in that. So, on Friday's performance, the first performance, I had to arrive 15 minutes late. So I slipped in the back and I sat down. And this play is a fast-paced, wacky murder/comedy. And my girls were careful in their rehearsing not to give anything away to Liesl and me. So we had no idea what was really happening when we'd see it the first time. But I came in 15 minutes late. So it took me quite a while to kind of start to figure out what's really going on here. And then when I got to see it, the whole thing, last night, I realized those 15 minutes, they set up all the rest of what happened through the rest of the play. And it made so much more sense to me. Coincidentally, one of the messages of the play is that what you may experience or see with your own eyes isn't telling the whole story. Our problem when we read the story about Elijah is we're getting the first 15 minutes of this much longer story, but it's like we sat down, we watched the 15 minutes, and we got up and left. And then thought we knew what it was about. It's crazy. We have in our head, oh yeah, Elijah did some more stuff. But we kind of think about it as more like in episodes that stand on their own. Not at all. The rest of the story tells us that Elijah is not being heroic by killing the prophets of Baal. It is not eliciting forth a hallelujah from us. It is eliciting a gasp of horror from us, as it should. Very quickly, it is Queen Jezebel, who's a worshiper of Baal, who has all the power, and then she gets her revenge, killing all the prophets of God, except Elijah, who's running for his life. And he believes he really is the only prophet left of the true God. He becomes depressed, and he wants to die. But God miraculously sustains him in the wilderness, and after 40 days of his tender care, God asks him, "What are you doing here, Elijah?" That is, what is the purpose of your life? Have you thought about that? And Elijah answers, "Hey, I'm trying to be bold and faithfully fight on your behalf. I'm helping prove you're the only true God and you have all the power." And Elijah must have been quite surprised when God simply doesn't assure him, "You got it, Elijah, you're my guy, I got your back, don't worry, as long as you got me, nobody can touch you." That's not what God does. God takes him to a mountain. He says, "Okay, I got a lesson for you, Elijah, here you go. Come up on the mountain with me," and he says that "I'm going to show you who I really am." And there was a strong, powerful wind. But God was not in the wind. And then there was an earthquake. Have you ever been in an earthquake? Unbelievable power. So scary. God wasn't in the earthquake. After the earthquake, a fire. Remember calling that fire down out of heaven? Unbelievable. That's like, awesome power. But the Lord's not in that fire. After the fire, the simple sound of sheer silence. And when Elijah heard it, he wrapped his face in a mantle and went out. God was in the silence. This is a clear repudiation of what Elijah believed about God. God isn't found in the dramatic displays of power Elijah had elaborately set up to prove who God was. No, God is in the silence. God is in the absence of any show of power. God is in the restraint of power, not in its use. God has the strength to be merciful. And tragically, Elijah never seems to get it. He dies insisting on his way rather than God's way. Even still, our God doesn't smite Elijah. Our God doesn't call down fire and destroy him. Instead, the fire is actually lifting him up and embracing him. Even though he horribly and wrongfully slaughtered hundreds of people in the name of a God whom, get this, he was misrepresenting. Wow. God continues to love and care for Elijah and hope that he and his people will one day repent from their propensity to use violence and to seek revenge. If we were lighting a candle in memory of Elijah on this All Saints Sunday, we would admire his unwavering commitment to God. We would see the best and forgive the rest. But that does not mean that everything he did was therefore good. We light a candle today in his memory in the hope that we may learn the lesson he failed to learn. Destroying our enemies is not the answer. And we can remember so that we ourselves do not fall into despair, even though evil seems to keep winning the day in the moment. It keeps happening. Even then, the smallest unseen acts of tender kindness and love that God has shown us is 1,000 times more powerful than the hate that we see every day. The hate that we readily see in others and unfortunately often are too reluctant to see in ourselves. May we light a candle so the hope of God's love may never be extinguished. In Jesus' name, amen. We sing today our hymn of the day, hymn number 315, How Good, Lord, to Be Here. May remain seated as a way of reflecting on that word. God's kingdom, as we sing together hymn number 692, We Are an Offering. To the Lord our God. It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God. Through our Savior, Jesus Christ, who, sharing our life, lived among us to reveal your glory and love, and that our darkness should give way to your own brilliant light. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup and he gave thanks and he gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." And our Lord has invited us to pray along with him. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. You may be seated. Then come, receive the grace that has already been prepared for you.